verticalis. If you see normal verticalis, it is superior view. In normal verticalis, you will see some bones. And these are in front, this frontal bone, and at the sides, parietal bones, and at the back, this is occipital bone. So these three bones we see on normal verticalis. These are frontal bone, parietal bones, and occipital bone. Now there are some sutures. What is a suture? Suture is a joint between skull bones. These are fibrous joints. These are immovable joints. So in normal verticalis, we see these sutures. This suture is in the coronal plane between frontal bone and parietal bones. This suture is coronal suture. Coronal suture. And you can see a suture in the mid-sagittal plane between the parietal bones. This is sagittal suture. And you can see a suture at the posterior part between occipital bone and parietal bones. This is lambdoid suture, lambda shape. So these sutures you can see on normal verticalis. This is coronal suture, this is sagittal suture, and this is lambdoid suture. And you can see a small foramen at the side of posterior part of sagittal suture. This foramen is parietal foramen. No significant structure passes through this parietal foramen. So in normal So in normal verticalis, you will see these. This is coronal suture, this is sagittal suture, and this is lambdoid suture, and this is frontal bone, parietal bone, and occipital bone. Now come on features of normal verticalis. If you remove the cap of normal verticalis, this cap is called culva or calvaria. This is culva or calvaria. And this is vault, also called this arch is vault of skull. What is vertex? Vertex is the highest point of the skull lying on the posterior part of sagittal suture. Usually in the normal delivery, vertex appears first. We call normal vertex delivery. So this is vertex. Parietal tubers are the prominences at the sides of parietal bones in the posterior parts. These are parietal tubers. So here you can see a meeting point between coronal suture and sagittal suture. This meeting point between coronal and sagittal suture is called bragma. And here you can see a meeting point between sagittal suture and lambdoid suture. This is called lambda. So we have bragma, we have lambda. But in infants, at the site of bragma, there is a depression because these bones, these sutures is not united. So this is called anterior fontanelle. And there is a gap, a depression at the site of lambda. This is called posterior fontanelle. Anterior fontanelle closes at the age of 18 months. Posterior fontanelle becomes closed at the age of 12 months. So anterior fontanelle is closed at 1 year of age and 1.5 year of age, and posterior fontanelle becomes closed at the age of 1 year. It is clear? So these anterior and posterior fontanelles are more depressed if there is dehydration. So these are the signs of levels of dehydration. So in norma verticalis, we have nothing, only these bones, frontal bone, parietal bones, and occipital bone. Only these three sutures, coronal suture, sagittal suture, and lambdoid suture. And we have vertex and parietal tubes. We have bragma, we have lambda. Here anterior fontanelle, here posterior fontanelle. Easy? Mm-hmm. In norma verticalis, any question? No question. It's very, very easy. Now we come on norma occipitalis. In norma occipitalis, this is norma occipitalis. Which bone you see norma occipitalis? This bone is occipital bone. And at the sides, these bones, mastoid part of temporal bone. And above, you can see posterior parts of parietal bone. So in normal occipitalis, you will see posterior parts of parietal bone and This is occipital bone, squamous part, and mastoid part of temporal bone. Clear? Yeah. Now sutures. In sutures, this was same lambdoid suture, and there is a suture between this suture was lambdoid suture same. The upper part we see in normal verticalis. This was lambdoid suture. Okay. Now there is a suture between occipital bone and mastoid temporal bone. So this must be occipito mastoid suture. Uh-huh. And there is a suture between parietal bone and mastoid temporal bone. This is parieto mastoid suture.
Okay.
This is parieto mastoid suture, and this is occipito mastoid suture, and this was lambdoid suture.
According to their size.
You name the two bones forming the suture.
Which one is this the first? Which one that you should take it first?
Anyone you know, like? If I say lambdoid suture, parieto mastoid, occipito mastoid, okay. If I say parieto mastoid, occipito mastoid, lambdoid, okay. If I say occipito mastoid, parieto mastoid, no problem. This is the name of suture. Okay?
Okay?
So these are the three sutures, and these are the three bones. Now, what features you see in norma occipitalis? This is the meeting point between these three sutures.
Exterior.
And in the median sagittal plane, there is a prominent point in the midline here. Can you see?
Yes, sir.
This is external occipital protuberance. External, it is outer.
Inion.
Occipital, on highest point is called inion, but no, it's not things. Too much detail not required. Otherwise, we'll not finish. So this is external occipital protuberance. Mm-hmm. Okay, clear? Now, from the external occipital protuberance, you can see a ridge is going with upward convexity, upwards and then laterally, towards mastoid process. This is superior nuchal line. Superior nuchal line. The superior nuchal line marks the junction between head and neck. Below the superior line, the structures are in the neck. And above the superior nuchal line, in the head. You can see the head. Mm-hmm. Now, above the superior nuchal line and parallel to it and not very clear are the highest nuchal lines. Sutures clear? Mm-hmm. Clear? Okay. Okay. So it's clear. External occipital protuberance and superior nuchal line. Superior nuchal line are very prominent ridges. Mark the junction between head and neck. Starting from external occipital protuberance, going laterally with upward convexity to the mastoid temporal. This is superior nuchal line. The important muscles are attached to it. Okay, clear? Each and every student understood every point?
Yes, sir.
All of you understand every point? Very clear? Very clear. Now we come on norma frontalis. So in norma occipitalis, nothing. Only we see three bones, occipital bone, mastoid temporal bone, and parietal. Only three sutures, lambdoid suture, parieto mastoid, occipital. Only two features. Three features you can say. External occipital protuberance, superior nuchal line, and exterior. Khalas? Now norma frontalis. In norma frontalis, what bones you see in norma frontalis?
Frontal.
Yes. This is a frontal bone which form the forehead. This forehead is frontal bone. Now nasal bones are forming most anterior part of lateral wall of nasal cavity, this is nasal bone. And this is nasal bone. Behind the nasal bone, we have, which bone is this?
Maxilla.
And later to maxilla, this is
zygomatic
bone. Okay. And this is zygomatic bone. This is maxilla. Some other bones you will see. You know, this is maxilla. The maxilla has some parts. This is body of maxilla. Body of maxilla have a cavity inside. That cavity contains air. That is called maxillary air sinus. So body of maxilla contains maxillary. If you take a knife and cut it, you will enter in the maxillary sinus. So maxillary sinus is the biggest paranasal air sinus. So paranasal air sinuses are the air containing cavities in the bone surrounding the nose, lining by mucous membrane, and they contain air and they open in the lateral wall of the nose by opening a posterior. So this body. Now this is alveolar process of maxilla. Alveolar process of maxilla bears sockets for the teeth of upper jaw. And this process of maxilla is going up. Can you see this going up? And this is upward articulating with the frontal bone. So this is frontal process of maxilla. And here this process is going towards zygomatic bone. Zygomatic process of maxilla. And this is nasal notch of maxilla. Nasal notch of maxilla forms the larger part of margin of anterior nasal aperture. So this is nasal notch of maxilla and this is anterior nasal spine. This is anterior nasal spine. So these are the parts of maxilla. So this is maxilla bone having alveolar process, having frontal process, having zygomatic process, having the body, having nasal notch, having anterior nasal spine.
The hollowing, the opening, opens to the eye or not? The opening of maxilla.
Yes, maxilla is, but you mean the...
You said the opening in maxilla.
Cavity. That cavity is maxillary air sinus.
Towards
yes,
the
its roof is formed by the floor of the orbit, you are saying. Roof is formed by the flow of the orbit and part of the medial wall is formed by the part of the lateral wall of the nasal cavity. And its floor is formed by the heart palate, barakatul halq. And anterior wall is formed by the anterior wall of body of maxilla. Posterior wall is formed by the posterior wall of body of maxilla.
What is the use of that?
Paranasal air sinuses, yes.
So,
number one, they use, this we will teach you in another, in a respiratory system block in second year. It is written, it is said that paranasal air sinuses, they give resonance to the voice and they lighten the skull.
Yes.
But there are some objections in this. What objection is this? Number one function is that they give resonance to the voice. There are many silent animals with big paranasal air sinuses. So this big objection. Second function is that paranasal air sinuses lightens the skull. If we don't have paranasal air sinuses, if all these bones are full, even then there will be not increase in the weight, not more than we have cigarette in the mouth, not more than that. So it is not important. So there are two functions, there are two big objections on the function. So there is no function. But there is one function. Function is that they give shape to the... How they shape this, we will tell you because in respiratory syndrome. So this is maxillary sinus, okay? So this is maxilla. Now this was nasal bone. And so behind the nasal bone, there is... Behind the nasal bone, there is frontal process of maxilla. Behind the frontal process of maxilla, there was lacrimal bone. Here lacrimal fossa go to the wire. And behind the lacrimal bone, there is ethmoid bone. Labyrinthine ethmoid bone. So these bones, but big bones you will see, maxilla, frontal bone, nasal bone, zygomatic bone. Okay? This is frontal process of zygomatic bone and this is temporal process of zygomatic bone. Sutures. This clear? So this is frontal bone, this is maxilla, this is zygomatic bone and this is lacrimal bone. This is lacrimal bone and this is sphenoid bone. left hand part of it one. This is it my one. This is
and then this
is it my. Now sutures. The sutures are many, but they are very easy. You name the two bones, and there is suture. For example, there is suture between right and left maxillary, intermaxillary suture. There is suture between maxilla and between maxilla and zygomatic bone, zygomaticomaxillary suture. Clear? There is suture between maxilla and between frontal zygomatic bone, zygomatico frontal suture. There is suture between two nasal bones, nasal suture. There is suture between nasal bone and maxilla, nasomaxillary suture. There is suture between maxilla and lacrimal bone, lacrimomaxillary suture. And we have frontonasal suture. And we have frontomaxillary suture. So very easy. There are many names, but you name the two bones and name the suture. What are sutures? Sutures are the fibrous joints between the skull bones. Joints between the skull bones are called the sutures. So these sutures easy. This is intermaxillary suture, internasal suture, nasomaxillary suture, lacrimomaxillary suture, frontonasal suture, frontomaxillary suture. Fronto and zygomatic frontal suture and zygomaticomaxillary suture. Yes,
Doctor, there is a formula about the what's it called?
Sir, 2 minutes. 1 minute. Okay. Clear? Clear sutures?
Yes.
Now foramen. Okay, but you are interested in foramen? So first foramen and then features. Okay, come on. You know, in foramina, there are three big foramina on the norma frontalis. One foramen is above the orbit. That is called the supraorbital foramen. Sometimes this is notch. So this is supraorbital foramen or supraorbital notch. And we have infraorbital foramen. And we have zygomaticofacial foramen. Can you see here? Zygomaticofacial foramen.
Would you use the frame of the
gun? Kill your moji there. Shabby,
where is it? Where is it?
Zygomaticofacial foramen is this. On the zygomatic bone, there is zygomaticofacial foramen. This is supraorbital nodular foramen. This is infraorbital foramen. Is clear? Very clear. Now features. In features, we have superciliary arch. Superciliary arch are the prominences more on the medial side above the orbital cavity. In the superciliary arch, it contains frontal air sinus. So, in the midpoint between the two superciliary arches is called glabella. Glabella is the midpoint between two superciliary arches. What is nasion? Nasion is the junction between internasal and frontonasal suture. So this point, this junction between these sutures is called nasion. And we have orbital, four-sided orbital opening that form the base of the orbital cavity or norma frontalis. And we have anterior bony aperture of the nose. So these features, you can see, these are the main features. They are, I'm not going to tell you many, many other things. These are the main features. Clear?
Yes.
Clear? Nothing. So in norma frontalis, nothing. We have maxilla and zygomatic bone. And we have sutures. We have intermaxillary suture, internasal suture, frontonasal suture, lacrimomaxillary suture, and nasomaxillary suture. And we have zygomaticomaxillary suture, zygomaticofrontal suture. And we have anterior nasal bony aperture. We have orbital cavity. we have glabella, we have supraciliary arch. Supraorbital foramen. Supraorbital foramen is exactly the same.
What's the difference
between glabella and nasion? Nasion is the meeting point between internasal suture and frontonasal suture. And glabella is a point in the midline between right and left superciliary arches. It's important in Parkinsonism disease. Is clear?
Yes.
Now we come on normal suture. Now normal lateralis. Normal lateralis we have done in temporal fossa and infratemporal fossa. Normal lateralis, these bones were clear.
Yes.
We have done yesterday.
Yes.
We have done these features.
Yes.
And we have done these features.
Yes.
What about the last two?
Last two.
Yes.
Last, if you asking about this,
no. Yes.
Then it is very strange.
Yes.
I think you are asking about last one.
Yes.
Pterygopalatine fossa. Pterygopalatine fossa is this space. If you pass a probe from infratemporal fossa, can you see there is a gap here?
Yes.
This gap is pterygomaxillary fissure between body of maxilla and pterygoid process. So this is pterygomaxillary fissure. If you put a probe from infratemporal fossa through the pterygomaxillary fissure, the probe will enter in this space. This space is called pterygopalatine fossa.
This one?
Pterygopalatine fossa. Pterygopalatine fossa is bounded anteriorly by the posterior surface of body of maxilla, posteriorly by the pterygoid process, laterally it opens through the pterygomaxillary fissure into the infratemporal fossa, medially it enters into the nasal cavity through the sphenopalatine foramen, and it contains third part of maxillary nerve and its branches, maxillary artery and its branches, and pterygopalatine ganglion. It is a parasympathetic ganglion for, yes?
Please, you boy, have this serious, huh?
Why
is
pterygopalatine fossa is bounded medially by the perpendicular plate of palatine bone, but don't go in detail. An anterior bound is formed by the pterygoid plate. Okay. So this is pterygopalatine fossa. Who asked this? M. Clear? This is pterygopalatine fossa. And they are, so there must be a separate class on this because they are walls, but many communications, contents are easy, many communications. It opens here and here, here and here, here and here, many. It opens anteriorly, posteriorly, laterally, medially. So this, I think, detail we will teach you in nervous system problem.
The just for question, the external loss, it's for
yes.
The inner ear, right?
No, no, yes.
Inner ear is there.
No, no, please listen, listen. Now keep quiet, students. With red hand, keep quiet. The question is just first ask one question then. The question is, what is external acoustic meatus and inner ear? Now, I will tell you that this part of bone is called mastoid temporal bone. This is mastoid from outside. This bone is mastoid temporal bone. Irregular, ugly shape. Khalas, this number one. Now, leave to advanced side. Now, what is ear? Anatomically, ear has three parts. External ear, middle ear, and inner ear. Remember, back, middle ear and external ear are lying within the petrous part of temporal bone. To see the middle ear and inner ear, you have to cut the petrous part of temporal bone. Inside the petrous part of temporal bone are lying middle ear and inner ear. Khalas? Khalas. Now what is external ear? External ear has two parts. Pinna or auricle and external acoustic meatus. Pinna is this. And external acoustic meatus is this. خلاص now external acoustic meatus outer part is cartilaginous and inner part is bony and bony part is this
yes
now clear
yes
very clear
وين الجحر اللي يقول عليه
If you go posterior superior, this is triangular in shape, posterior superior, to the external of the meatus, there is supramedial triangle, which is bounded above by the supramedial triangle, Students with yellow notebook. Now normal lateralis, any student have any question on normal lateralis, please ask for me. In normal lateralis, any point? Yes.
But on this one,
What is the difference between? Infrared and temporal fossa, I am not going to tell you what is. Nine is this. I am shouting for the last 5 minutes about the infratemporal, pterygopalate and fossa. Now, norma basalis is a very difficult thing and not easy, so easy nor other, not like other. So, this is. Norma basalis. So norma basalis is a difficult thing. So for purpose of study, we will divide the norma basalis in 3 parts. You know what is this? This is varakatul hard palate. So if you draw a line at the posterior margin of hard palate, this we can see and first study this part of norma basalis. Then if you draw a line at the anterior margin of foramen magnum, then we study middle part, and then we will study the posterior part of norma basalis. The middle part is more difficult. So start one by one. So norma basalis anterior part. So and it is anterior part is bounded anterior laterally by the alveolar arch. What is alveolar arch? Alveolar arch is formed by the alveolar process of maxilla that bears sockets for the teeth of upper. These are teeth of upper jaw. So this is anterior part is formed by hard palate. Anterior part forms the hard palate, which is bounded anterior laterally by the alveolar arch of maxilla. And it forms, hard palate is formed by 2 bones, by maxilla and by palatine bones. Horizontal plate of palatine bone and palatine process of maxilla. So anterior 2/3 or anterior 3/4 is formed by maxilla and posterior 1/3 or posterior like this. Okay, here is it. You can see skull in your hands. This is all hard palate. So this is maxilla and this is palatine bone. This is palatine process of maxilla and this is horizontal plate of palatine bone. The sutures are intermaxillary suture, interpalatine suture and palatomaxillary suture. Clear? Intermaxillary suture, interpalatine and palatomaxillary suture. Foramen, this is incisive foramen, the incisive fossa and this incisive foramen, and greater incisive foramen, which structures I will tell you in after 15 minutes, structures passing through incisive foramen. This is at the posterior lateral corner of hard palate, can you see this foramen?
Yes.
This is greater palatine foramen. And behind the greater palatine, they are small, maybe 2, maybe 3, maybe 1, lesser palatine. Greater and lesser palatine foramen leads into the greater and lesser palatine canal that opens in the pterygopalatine fossa. This is greater palatine foramen. Mm. This is lesser. If you pass a small probe, it will enter interigopalatine fossa. So in anterior part of norma basalis, you will see annular arch, you will see hard palate that is formed by palatine process of maxilla and horizontal plate of palatine bone. You will see intermaxillary suture, interpalatine suture, and palatomaxillary suture. You will see incisive foramen, greater palatine, and lesser palatine foramen. That's all. Very easy.
Yes.
Now, middle part.
We go from the middle part.
Middle part, we divide the middle part because middle part is many features. So we divide the middle part into median area and lateral area. So median area, this area. This is median area and this is lateral area. In the median area, you will see, you know, what is this antenasal aperture? If you pass a probe, it will enter where the probe is going.
So the
in the nasopharynx. Through this foramen. What is this foramen? This is posterior nasal aperture. Posterior nasal aperture is called coina. Two coini.
Yes.
Coini is pleural, jama. And coina is vahi. So this is posterior nasal aperture or coini. This is coini or posterior nasal aperture. Now, behind this, we see a broad bore of bone, this, with 2x. This broad bore of bone is formed by two bones, by occipital bone, basilar part of the occipital bone behind, and by body of the sphenoid bone. Body of sphenoid bone and basilar part of occipital bone. This broad bore of bone forms roof of nasopharynx. You know pharynx alveolum.
Yes.
Pharynx has got three parts behind the nose, nasopharynx, behind the mouth, oropharynx, behind the larynx, laryngopharynx. So roof of the pharynx, roof of the nasopharynx is formed by this broad bore of bone. Okay? So these we will see in the median area, in the lateral area, we see two parts, this is lateral area. In lateral area, we see two parts of sphenoid bone and three parts of temporal bone. Two parts of sphenoid bone is pterygoid process of sphenoid bone and infratemporal surface of greater wing of sphenoid bone. Okay. What is pterygoid process? Pterygoid process is this. Can you see pterygoid process?
Yes.
Pterygoid process anteriorly, pterygoid process anteriorly meet with the body of maxilla. But in the upper part, it formed the pterygomaxillary fissure. And through the pterygomaxillary fissure, infratemporal fossa communicates with the pterygopalatine fossa. But anteriorly, this pterygoid process splits into lateral pterygoid plate and medial pterygoid plate. Lateral pterygoid plate forms the medial boundary of infratemporal fossa, and medial pterygoid plate forms the posterior part of lateral wall of nasal cavity. It was very clear. I told you in the lecture yesterday also.
Just describe.
Just. Okay. Now see. And this is no. Can you see M? Here M. Now, you see lateral pterygoid plate. Lateral pterygoid plate is this, and medial pterygoid plate is this. So lateral pterygoid plate, as I told yesterday, then lateral pterygoid plate form the medial boundary of infratemporal fossa. And medial pterygoid plate form the lateral boundary of nasal cavity, lateral wall of nasal.
Nasal cavity, yes.
Okay. So in the lateral part of middle part of norma basalis, you will see these two parts of sphenoid bone, pterygoid and infratemporal surface of greater wing of isunite that forms roof of infratemporal fossa. Now parts of temporal bone. In temporal bone we see vitreous part of temporal bone and tympanic plate and squamous part. Vitreous part of temporal bone is this. Very irregular and ugly shape. This is vitreous part of temporal bone and here we see squamous part of temporal bone and we see tympanic. Actually tympanic plate of temporal bone is this. Tympanic plate of temporal bone, its anterior surface forms the part of external acoustic meatus and anterior surface of the tympanic plate of temporal bone forms the posterior part of mandibular fossa. What is mandibular fossa? This is tympanic plate of temporal
bone. To hold the mandible.
Tympanic plate of temporal bone, posterior surface form the external anterior part of external acoustic meatus and anterior surface form the posterior part of mandibular fossa. This mandibular fossa articulates with the head of the mandible to form the temporomandibular joint. Clear? And this is vitreous part of temporal bone. Vitreous part of temporal bone. Is clear? Now foramen foramina. I need something. You give me few seconds, maybe I'll see my office.
عاد الله يعينكم ويشوف وتقدر تهدي.
يعني هو قابل المسألة.
يا حبيبي هذه ظهر الشرع لي خمس مرات.
خلص. هو مصاحب ترى. في أشياء موجودة.
يعني شطة.
في أشياء موجودة هنا أصلاً.
كل كلام.
شوف هذا اللي جاء يشري شيء لنفسه.
أنا أتكلم بعد.
تدري وش فيه؟ كله يعني بيقول لك يعني قصد
ايش راح يجيب يعني؟
من مكتوب؟
هلا والله.
لا. Can you see this foramen?
Yes.
This foramen is a big foramen, oval in shape. This is foramen ovale. This foramen, big foramen, oval in shape, is foramen ovale. And posterior lateral to the foramen ovale, circular in shape and smaller in size, this is foramen spinosum. Foramen spinosum. And there is foramen lacerum. Can you see foramen lacerum? Foramen lacerum. And there is a carotid canal. In the vitreous temporal bone, it is very clear, in the vitreous temporal bone, there is carotid canal.
Where is it?
In the vitreous temporal bone. Pterygoid canal is very difficult to see. If you see very carefully anterior margin of foramen lacerum, then you will see small foramen. From anterior margin, it's very difficult to see, very small, and it will lead into the pterygopalatine fossa. So this is foramen lacerum. Foramen lacerum. This is foramen ovale. This is foramen spinosum. This is carotid canal.
And all of this foramen in the sphenoid bone, and temporal bone.
No. But foramen ovale and foramen spinosum are located on the infratemporal surface of greater ring of spinal bone. Carotid canal in the petrous part of temporal bone. Foramen lies between these three bones, between occipital bone and between the petrous temporal bone and between the spinae. It's clear? The posterior part of norma basalis. In posterior part, norma basalis is very, very easy. It's nothing. In the posterior part, we have squamous part of occipital bone, we have condylar part of occipital bone, and we have histoidal process part of temporal bone. So this is squamous part of occipital bone, and condylar part of occipital bone is this, which form the condyle and which is articular, is smooth, covered by hyaline cartilage, articulate with the superior articular facet of first cervical vertebra, that is atlas, to form the atlanto-occipital joint. So condyle, this atlanto-occipital joint, this is.
Yes.
Why atlanto? Because first cervical vertebra is atlas. Why it is called atlas? We will tell you. Atlanto-occipital joint, because it is formed between occipital bone and atlas. So atlanto-occipital joint, this is. This is condylar part of occipital bone.
Yes.
Actually, condylar part is all this. One part is this. And all this is, we discussed before. The squamous part of occipital bone. Foramen here, a big foramen is here. What is the name of this foramen?
Magnum.
Foramen magnum. What passes through it?
Spinal cord.
Atlas. Slide.
Now, other foramen. Very, very important foramen is jugular foramen. This is jugular foramen. It's a very important foramen here. Jugular foramen. This is jugular foramen. And stylomastoid foramen, small foramen, but also very important. And it is lying at the base of stryloid process. Behind the stryloid process, you will see there is stylomastoid foramen.
Yes.
And anterior to the occipital condyle, there is anterior condylar canal. Other name is hypoglossal canal. Hypoglossal canal or anterior condylar canal is at the line at the anterior to the occipital condyle. And posterior to it, there is, but sometimes not present, or very small, this is posterior condylar canal. So in this, we have foramen magnum, we have anterior condylar canal, posterior condylar canal, we have jugular foramen, and we have stylomastoid foramen.
Now all of these foramen is for what?
So the
blood vessels, near,
after 2 minutes. For nerves. I give in 1 minute some concept about the foramen. You know nerves?
Yeah.
Nerves are spinal nerves and cranial nerves.
Mm-hmm.
Spinal nerves are 31 in pair. Spinal nerves are those nerves which are attached to the spinal cord, come from spinal cord. And cranial nerves are 12 pairs in number.
Twelve in number.
Cranial nerves are 12 in number, not 7. So cranial nerves are those nerves which are attached to the brain. But where the brain is inside the skull. Okay. So cranial nerve, supply the structures.
Yes.
Where those structures are lying, inside the skull or outside the skull?
Yes.
Outside the skull? Inside.
Just one minute.
First, understand what I'm asking.
Yes.
I am saying that cranial nerves are those nerves which are attached, which emerge from brain.
Mm-hmm.
And they supply some structures, some muscles and joints and this and this and skin. Okay. And glands. Do the cranial nerves supply the structures which are inside the skull or outside the skull? Do you have any muscles inside the skull? Any skin? Any bone? Any joint? Any ligament? Any gland? Any smooth muscle?
No.
Nothing, only brain. So all these structures are outside the skull. It means these cranial nerves should leave the skull, should leave the cranial cavity by passing through apertures. These apertures are called the foramina.
Yes.
So these apertures, the foramina, are for the exit of cranial nerves because they have to supply the structures here and there. Okay? Clear or not?
Yes.
Yes. Second thing, there are, because brain is supplied by the arteries, and arteries are going where? Arteries going from the heart. So they will come from where? From the jump? No. Through the foramen they will enter. And lymphatics. And veins. Okay? Okay. There are no lymphatics, but this will discuss in end of this. Yes, why not? What do you know? Now foramina chart. Now I will tell you. Don't discuss with each other. You discuss with each other after this class. Now anything you ask for. Now foramina chart. The structures passing through the foramen. Supraorbital foramen transmits supraorbital nerve and supraorbital nerves. Infraorbital foramen transmits infraorbital nerve and infraorbital vessels. Zygomatofacial foramen transmits zygomatofacial nerve and zygomatofacial vessels. Very, very easy. No problem? No problem. Now we come on incisive canal. Incisive canal is this. Nasopalatine nerve and greater palatine vessels. Nasopalatine nerve and greater palatine vessels. From where to where these nerves and vessels are going, this we will going to tell you in other blocks. But at this stage, nasopalatine nerve and greater palatine vessels. Greater palatine canal, greater palatine nerve, greater palatine vessels. Lesser palatine canal, lesser palatine nerve and lesser palatine vessels. Easy? Very easy? This is foramina. Okay. Now we come. From ovale. Now some foramina are more important. So this foramen ovale, foramen spinosum, these are important ones. Foramen ovale is this. Foramen ovale transmits very important nerve, that is mandibular nerve. This is for mandibular nerve and lesser petrosal nerve.
Yes.
Two nerves very important for foramen ovale, that is mandibular nerve and lesser petrosal nerve. And anterior trunk of middle meningeal way and accessory meningeal artery. Through the foramen spinosum passes nervus spinosus. That is actually the meningeal branch of mandibular nerve. Nervus spinosus. Yes, meningeal branch of mandibular nerve, but very important structure is middle meningeal artery. Okay? Understand or not? Foramen ovale, remember, foramen ovale transmits mandibular and lesser petrosal nerves.
What is it?
And foramen spinosum transmits middle meningeal artery and nervus spinosus.
Sorry, where is the foramen spinosum?
Foramen spinosum is behind the foramen ovale.
Behind the foramen?
Okay. Posterior lateral the foramen ovale. Small in size, circular in shape.
Must be this 55, isn't it?
At the posterior medial margin of infratemporal surface of the lateral of spinal cord. Very small in size, circular in shape, posterior lateral to the foramen.
Posterior lateral.
Yes. So this is foramen ovale. Is this foramen ovale? Very clear.
Yes.
Very clear. Now we come on. Carotid canal is for internal carotid artery. I am telling you only the big foramina, few foramina which are very big, and only the important structures passing through those. This is carotid canal for internal carotid artery, and pterygoid canal is very difficult to see for nerve of pterygoid canal and vessels of pterygoid canal. The stylomastoid foramen is very important foramen. It is very important foramen because it transmits facial seventh cranial nerve. This is stylomastoid foramen. You can see just behind the stylet process. Stylomastoid foramen transmits facial nerve. Facial nerve, seventh.
Yes.
It enters through this No, it exits through this. Because the facial nerve enters into the petrous temporal bone through the internal acoustic meatus, that there is a course in the middle ear cavity, then it comes out through the sternomastoid foramen. Now we have jugular foramen is a very, very important foramen. Jugular foramen is this. Middle part of jugular foramen transmits 9, 10th and 11th cranial nerves. That is glossopharyngeal, vagus and accessory nerves.
Yes.
Middle part of jugular foramen transmits 9, 10th and 11th. Which are glossopharyngeal, vagus and accessory nerves. And posterior part transmits internal jugular vein and anterior part transmits inferior petrosal sinus.
Very important.
Jugular foramen, sternomastoid. Jugular foramen transmits, middle part transmits 9, 10th and 11th cranial nerves. Posterior part transmits internal jugular vein. Anterior part for inferior petrosal sinus. What is this? We will tell you in nervous system. Foramen magnum. Foramen magnum transmits, you said spinal cord, you were right, but lower part of medulla oblongata. Actually, medulla oblongata changes its name as spinal cord after passing through the jugular foramen at the upper margin of arch of atlas. So here it is called. So medulla oblongata covered in meninges. Medulla oblongata and meninges. That is pia mater, arachnoid mater, and dura mater. And spinal part of accessory nerve. And vertebral arteries. And anterior spinal cord. And posterior spinal cord. I am not going to tell you membrana tectoria and apical ligament of dens. And I am not going to tell you cerebellar tonsils. No, this is just progeny.
But what is the anterior and superior spinal artery?
This is vertebral artery, right and left vertebral artery joined to form the basilar artery. Basilar artery divides into posterior cerebral arteries. This is vertebral arteries. Okay, this is basilar artery. Vertebral arteries, then this artery supply the brain, this artery. This is foramen magnum. Foramen magnum. Right and left vertebral arteries enter into the cranium by passing through the foramen magnum. Vertebral arteries gives anterior spinal artery, anterior joint, to supply the spinal cord, and they come out through the jugular through the foramen magnum, and vertebral archer gives the posterior spinal arteries to supply the posterior part of the spinal cord. It also comes out through the foramen magnum. Hypoglossal canal transmits hypoglossal nerve, that is 12th cranial nerve. Hypoglossal nerve, that is 12th cranial nerve.
Thin.
Thin. Any questions now? Very clear? Yes. Skull is a very difficult topic, but I try to make it most simple and easy.
موضوع سهل وقف يروح بس هو لا لازم ما عاد كل مره شيء يقوم يتذكر كله
ما كنت تحضير
ايه تحضير ايه
اهم شيء يبتسم لليوتيوب كل اخوك بيشوفوني كل واحد فوق حاتم حي الجماهير ما يحب الجماهير هذا
شباب شباب واحد